I'm Vicky Blight, sat in the vault of the Hard Rock Cafe in London with the marvellous John from Cast.
Yeah, how are you doing?
I'm all right, how are you?
Do you want me to talk into this?
Better hand. All right, yeah. You know, for radio and stuff like
okay,
that.
Okay, right, yeah. Of course.
We can see you.
Of course, I'm getting put off by the cameras.
Want to hear you as well. Okay, yeah. Well?
Yeah, how are you doing?
I'm all right. Yeah, not too bad. We're sat around. You just noticed John Entwistle's guitar from
yeah,
The Who.
Yeah, that's right. We used to spend our summers there in his house, actually recording all our demos. For the albums and that. We used to go up like for the summer for about 6 weeks and nice. Hang out with them, like, you know, in the Barracuda Bar, which was like a, not unlike this place really, but it was his own bar.
Nice.
In his massive house, like.
Tipple of choice?
His. Mm. Armagnac, like a brandy.
Right.
Yeah, that was his favourite. Yeah.
Expensive taste. Expensive
well,
taste.
He was only in the Who, wasn't he?
I know. He can splash out, I'm sure. Have you ever bid for anything? Anything like this, then? Have you got any rare treasures in your possession?
I've never bid for anything, though, but I do have one or two decent guitars, you know. I've got a rare Martin and a couple of guitars, but nothing really like that you'd get hanging up in there, you know.
Would you ever play Silly Money for something? Is there
I
anything
got
out
silly
there?
Money.
But honestly, is there anything? Is there anything that you would go, do you know what, I shouldn't, but I will?
Do you know, I'm coming to a point in my life where actually, maybe a few years back, 10 years, you know, you think like that, but really, possessions, you know, my pockets are only so big, like, you know.
It's just a pain in the ass when
well,
you move.
Well, it's just, you know, you want these things, and when you get them, like, you know, where do you get with them?
Mm.
You know, I'd rather just be all right with what I've got. You know, socialist at heart, really.
Nice.
Know?
Nice. It's inspiring.
Yeah.
You're playing a session upstairs tonight for Absolute Radio and Hard Rock. New album
That's
on the
right,
way,
yeah.
Which
Trouble
is very
Time.
Exciting.
Out March the 5th or 4th, something like that.
March the 5th?
Yeah.
New single as well?
Yeah, Time Bomb, that's right. We've had one out, See That Girl. The band are together again after, like, you know, being apart for about 10 years. We worked with John Leckie all last summer. Got this new album together, which came about really from just kind of writing some new songs, which weren't really a kind of rootsy solo stuff, which is what I was doing for the last 8 years. And here we are now, playing a few gigs. It's great, really. It's good to be kind of back. I'm interested how it's going to turn out, how it's going to be received, really, you know.
Yeah, I mean, reaction from old and new fans. There's
people who don't like the band, people who do like the band, but it'd be nice to hear the people in the middle of how they feel about the album. Like, it's got a kind of, it's got a looseness to it. And it's nice not to just be kind of, we wouldn't have got back together for just the nostalgia.
Yeah.
You know, we wanted to have something current, you know. So
were you writing stuff whilst you were kind of doing your own solo things? Did you have in the back of your head some point, you know, it'd be nice if we all got back together and threw some ideas around? Did you have anything
funny,
in your back
for a long,
pocket?
Long while, I never had any thoughts whatsoever of reforming Cast. Never played any of the Cast stuff for about 8 years. I was playing like this rootsy kind of folk blues stuff. And if you'd have asked me that question about, you know, 2 years ago, I would, you know, really not have seen it coming. What happened was I get this rhythm that's found in like Time Bomb, you'll hear it throughout the set. And it started to write some songs. And all of a sudden it became apparent that it wasn't a solo album. It was going to be like a band thing. And then I was thinking and it just started to kind of slowly form in my head that it was going to be a Cast album. And it took about a year and a half really of me on my own writing stuff, and then I rang the lads, you know, which was, I mean, I never fell out with them and we never fell out with each other, but we'd certainly got on with our lives, you know. And then we spent all the last year kind of getting back together, seeing if we had a relationship as musicians and friends. And and here we are now with the album coming out, like, which is, in one way, it's kind of, you know, it's kind of quite a great thing for me, because all of a sudden I've made my peace with your walkaways and your fine times and all right, you know, because I really fell out of love with who I was, if that makes sense.
Because I was going to ask you, like, REM famously never play Shiny Happy People, because it's just something they're just like, nah, don't want to go back there,
yeah.
Don't want to play it. Are there any songs that you would refuse to play or not be keen to play?
I refused to play all of them for a good while. People used to shout them out to me and I just really didn't have the heart to sing them. I didn't want to be a parody. I didn't want it to feel like that, but I think it all comes down to writing new material that you feel really happy with, and because of that, that's kind of balanced out the past with the present and the future, and all of a sudden I feel really happy again. I mean, it's not like happy, oh dear, happy, but I've got a great feeling now about singing them songs. And in a way, I've missed it. You know, it maybe like kind of all those years of not being together has counted for something, because all of a sudden I recognise how good the band are. I recognise what great songs they are and what a great fan base we've got. And singing them now is you know, is kind of, I'm getting a real kind of reward, if that makes sense. Like, you know.
Was it you that kind of went after John Leckie and said, come on, let's do this, like the good old days?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I spoke to John today, actually, to see if he was going to come down tonight. He just got back from Norway. But John, it's very funny. I've worked with John throughout my career. I think I've done about 4 albums with him, you know. Nearly 5, you know what I mean? And we've got a real kind of sense between each other. We just get on really well musically and, you know, as people. And it was obvious the minute the band got back together, and I knew the strength of the songs, or I wouldn't have even got the band back together. Like, and I just thought John's going to love this. Like, and he just listened to the demos and was kind of, you know, yeah, let's get together. We all got together, and it was great, really. You know,
what song
felt
are you
right to get back with? You know, with John and the band. Here we go again.
What song are you most excited about performing when you get on stage for your tour?
Of the new stuff?
Yeah.
Well, I'm really looking forward. I can't wait for the tour in March and April. I'm really looking forward to playing a lot of the new album, like 8-9 songs. It's been so long now. It's like I've been working on them. And I really need to get them. I need to give them a life, really, of their own.
See the reaction as well, yeah.
But there's a couple of songs. I'm Not Afraid of the World, which is a song on the album, which... It's just got something, I don't know what it is. I don't know whether it's my favourite song, but it's certainly got some. You know, it's got something. But there's a lot of songs, you know, Bad Waters, Bow Down, Time Bomb and all that. And there's loads more. I'm looking forward to it all. I'll tell you next time I speak to you.
Yep.
I'll tell you which ones.
That's it. Nice. What do you guys get up to then when you're on tour? And how has it changed from back in the day?
Well, you've heard the saying, what goes on tour stays
on tour.
Yeah, sorry,
okay,
I'll rephrase. We signed that deal 15 years ago. Like.
I'll rephrase. Yeah. What do you get up to in your downtime between the gigs?
Nah, it's all, you know, we're all a lot more kind of, we've all grown up, you know, and there's a little bit of relaxation going on and stuff like that. But, you know, we all get in our bunks. We don't stay up for days. You know, ukulele club.
Nice.
Ukulele club. Everyone get ukuleles out and we get on the back seat.
Sounds like a school trip now on your bus.
Soup, you know, making food and I don't know, you know. It's funny, isn't it?
It does sound like a scout trip, let's
scout
be honest.
Scout trip, yeah, there you go, dear me.
Little burners, little stoves cooking up a treat.
Don't join our brigade.
Tour venues. What is the best venue that you've ever played? Either with the band or solo?
That's a question now, really, because there are... Some gigs are memorable because of the energy and the reaction of the audience and the participation between the two. Other places, you walk in the sound check and you see like an old Art Deco theatre or something, and you think, wow, this is just amazing, you know. So there's lots of great venues. I couldn't tell you, it's like saying what's your favourite song, you know.
We put on a gig with Elbow in the crypt of St Paul's Cathedral.
Oh, right. Okay.
So are there any unusual venues that you'd
play? Ironically, we played in the crypt in the Metropolitan Cathedral in Liverpool, which was quite cool, you know. I mean, it was a bit brittle because the sound, it was all stone and all that, you know. But that was quite cool, yeah. You know, getting all old religious on me.
So there are no places, stadiums or anything like that?
Stadiums? We were never, we did a few big, massive things. Like, I mean, we did Nebworth with Oasis, we played with U2, and one of the stories was we were going to play with the Stones, got in touch to play the Olympic Stadium in Berlin. And then Keith Richards fell off his ladder going for a Leonardo da Vinci book and broke his wrist. And the gig was cancelled. So that's one of my regrets. Like, but generally, we were more on, like, you know, I mean, we play like the Brixton Academies and the theatres, really. You know, we play, you know, Glastonbury's and outdoor places like that. We were in a stadium rock band. By God, no.
I didn't know whether you wanted to get out in front of those Liverpool fans.
It's funny, you know, the bigger the audience, sometimes the less connection you have with them.
Lose the vibe.
Ironically, like, you know, sometimes it's worse playing, sometimes playing in the kitchen with like 15 people, you know, because everyone's riding, they can see, they can feel the breath. and see the creases in your head as you're going for notes. You know?
I definitely prefer smaller gigs.
Yeah.
It's all about intimate gigs. You mentioned Oasis. Noel playing the Brit Awards last night.
Yeah, I didn't see it, but I did actually. I was in touch with Noel the other week actually. But
he's up for the Godlike Genius Award at the Enemy.
Godlike Genius
at the Enemy Awards.
Big words,
I know they are.
I mean, Gandhi was a genius. But Einstein was a genius.
Do you think he deserves it though? Do you
Jesus
think that's
was godlike? But, you know... Is he up there? It's the media, isn't it, who give these massive titles. Noel writes a really good tune, right? You know, very astute guy, like, you know.
What do you think of his solo stuff, High Flying Birds?
Well, I mean, it doesn't really need me to say, because it's he's proven himself once again to be successful. You know, he sold a lot of records in a time where people aren't selling records. The public really aren't buying records like they used to. I mean, when Cast were out 10 years ago, whatever it was, people followed bands. They went out and bought the CD or the 7-inch on a Saturday, you know, and they watched Top of the Pops or a certain show. But now you've got so many music shows, it's all diluted. I don't even know what the charts are. I don't know if people buy CDs. I mean, kids, I don't think kids do.
Do you think it's
Come
taken
on, kiddies,
something away? You know. Is it taken something away from being a music lover?
Well, it has to me, but then...
It has to me as well, because I always remember going in into town Saturday, pick up new singles.
He's busy on Facebook, aren't he? You know, trying to get popular.
Do you Facebook? Do you tweet?
I tweet now and again for the band, because I was told I should. Do I Facebook? No. Do I tweet? Really, you know.
More professional thing.
Well, I mean, you know, now and again, you'd something funny, or if the band are here, if we're on the road, you know, maybe I'll do a couple of tweets. If we're in the studio, I'll do a couple of tweets. You know, maybe I'll tweet, I've just spoke to you.
Nice.
You know, there
do
you
it.
Go.
I'll follow you.
Yeah, there you go.
During your tour, see what you're getting up to.
All right.
Then I'll find out what goes on tour.
Yeah. Stays on tour.
Blur, another 90s band, yeah. Getting the Outstanding Contribution to
it's
Music Award. have you been fans of the band throughout?
Blur,
yeah, yeah. Or were you always more on the side of Oasis?
Well, obviously, we you know, I think naively, when we were signed and where we came from, we were more like a northern thing, you know. I think Blair are a very, very good band. I think Damon's, a very talented lad. You know, I mean, 15 years ago, I was a different guy, like, you know. So
so was
he. You've got attitude. I mean, you've got to go through all that growing up thing. Mm. You know, I mean, you think you're great when you're young, like, even if you're not.
Come on now, though. As slightly more middle-aged men,
yes.
Noel versus Damon in a wrestling type Olympic affair.
Well, listen,
who would come out on top?
About your secret fantasies.
Come on,
all
do
right.
It. You know, I need something.
I don't know
to
what
go
you were dreaming
to.
Of, but I don't go there. Like, I mean, I certainly don't spend time thinking about two grown men
in lycra
wrestling.
See, I've thought about this a lot.
I want to watch men wrestling. I'll put Ollie Reed on and that naked wrestling that film. I don't know what it was like, but I think all that sort of, you know, bravado. I mean, the Britpop, and, you know, I mean, it was exciting at the time, and people make a big deal of stuff. Most people, when you see them, you get on with them, they're all sound, you know.
Do you think music's got a bit soft now, though? Do you think the industry
has
softened?
I think it has indeed, yeah. I think it's missing a bit of bite, like, and whether that will come back because of the economic, you know, time, what's going on, people are feeling the pinch. Just seems like there's too many comfortable people in comfortable positions doing music. It's a bit too comfortable, you know. And I don't need me to say it, because I've been, you know, in two very, you know, kind of great bands, the Lars and Cast, and I've been around for 20-odd years musically, like. But I certainly think there's, you know, the journalists, the kind of the music, it just seems a bit like there's a lot of... It's top-heavy middle class, and this isn't a class war thing, but I just wonder, like, if it's missing a little bit of spite and spit and, you know, hopelessness when you've got nothing and all you've got is this thing that you're going to make it work, you know, a bit of venom, like, you know. But I think, you know, you only got to look around and see the world, you know, in the papers, on the TV, out your window. There's certainly things going down which are abrasive, you know, emotionally and economically, like, and I just hope from that you'll get a some sort of movement that will kind of just kick the, you know, give it a kick up the bottom, shall we say. Like,
the music industry seems to have kind of gone through a period of
soul, like.
Well, and it's gone through a period of loss. Like, the last 12 months, it seems weird kind of losing people, like high-profile people like Amy Winehouse.
Yeah.
Do you think that the industry still has a kind of hopeless side in terms of it does take its victims? Do people just not handle the lifestyle?
No, look, people, you know, regardless, people are always living on the edge, and people will always fall by the wayside, you know. A lot of people get through it. A lot of people don't, and that's been, you know, throughout history, you'll see that. And musicians, as much as anyone, you know, creative, the arts, artists, whatever, they, you know, they tend to need this extreme, you know, pull and push of life, you know, because steadiness and comfortable feelings don't really give you too much to shout or long for. You know, when you're writing something or singing something, you certainly don't want to feel safe. And if I want to make some sort of connection, and I don't mean I sit down and try that, but when I'm singing or trying to hit a note or trying to get something, I mean, it's out of reach. And that's half the beauty. I think what people have always loved in their artists is that they see people longing for something that's just out of reach, you know. And we all wish for that, what's out of our reach, you know. And I think that's kind of why you get people kind of, you know, going around and getting off their heads, like, you know, whether it was Skag and jazz days, right through rock and roll, right through whatever, punk, speeding your head off, right through to, you know, people will always try something, stimulants, and don't do it, kids.
Just say no.
Just say no.
New music-wise, then, who's excited you over the last 12 months? Are there any bands that you are keeping your eye on? Try and catch
you
live.
You know what? I can't keep up with the kids today, like. You know,
they don't necessarily have to be kids.
No, I mean, I have heard good music knocking around, and you know, but I tend not to kind of, you know, I haven't really. Let me put it this way: when you're writing an album, you become self all-consuming. You know, you just throw yourself at it, and you very rarely come out listening. You know, trying to check out what's going on. You know, it's something that you have to throw yourself into, and something. I'm only just come off of air; like, it's only going to be released in the next few weeks. You know, maybe after that I'll sit back and start checking music out. You know, I'm sure there's great things going on. It's like, you know, the youth, people growing up, it's their time, isn't it? You know, it's their time. They're all falling in love. They're all, summer's coming, summer, whatever, in their lives. I'm saying, you know, it's kind of spring in their lives. They're at a good point. If you were young, I wouldn't want to go back there. Like, I'm quite happy where I am in life. I don't want to...
So when the dust has settled after the tour, the album's out, You've kind of chilled into it all.
Retire.
don't say that.
Get a garden.
Don't say that.
No, I'm not, like, I'm not going to stop writing music. I've never stopped writing music. So it's just that we've all of a sudden got the opportunity to talk to people like yourself and play gigs like this again, you know.
Would you work with anyone else? Would Cass be open to a collaboration?
Oh, yeah. I mean, to be honest with you, I even individual band members, I mean, I think... When you first start, you're like, you know, thick as thieves. Now it's like, you know, if people have got something they've got to do, then do it, you know. And we've got this kind of understanding now that, you know, we together are cast, you know, and we should get together to make music because we're having, you know, it really feels good. We've just done this album. But if, you know, I mean, Peter's going to do it, just doing a little solo thing called Aviator or something like that. Skin's playing around here and there. I mean, I've still got songs that are more... that don't suit cast, maybe, that are more rootsy, you know, a bit more, that I'll probably want to do, whether that's a solo thing or whatever, a collaboration, who knows? Yeah, you know.
Yeah, we're open to offers, man.
Open to offers, and less paranoid now, maybe.
Oh, I'm not, yeah, of course I am.
Yeah.
Yes.
Of course you are.
I'm much, less paranoid than I used to be. I'm less uptight, and a bit more relaxed, and yeah.
I went to see Backbeat on stage in London, based on the film Early Days of the Beatles in Hamburg, playing all the red light district dodgy clubs.
Yeah.
If you could make a film about any band, who would you want to kind of share the untold story with?
Well, I'd love the untold story. I'd like I think the Lars, I really would love that to kind of get it together and release and get some stuff going. There's a great story there. It's a great story in every band, though, you know. When you said about playing the small clubs and all that. I mean, I can remember, you know, with Cast and the Lars play. I mean, there's circuits out there and you're playing. I mean, there's some real dives, but they're exciting as hell, like, you know, at that age.
And the people
sweaty,
you meet.
Brickwork, you know. It's great, you know. That's all. They're all stories. These are, I mean, hasn't everyone got a story to tell? Isn't every life a script of some sort? Like, you know.
Who would play you then in this film?
I don't know. Some curly headed Scouser. Some curly headed guy who can do a Scouse accent. I don't know.
I think we'll have flocks of them coming to the auditions. Talking about Liverpool then, Carling Cup final against Cardiff.
I'm going.
Are you?
Got me ticket, yeah.
Nice. Predictions? Yeah.
Well, you know, I don't like to foretell the future. I think we've got... Look, if Liverpool play on their day, there's no... You know, we should... It's ours, really. You know, but I mean, like anyone, can't underestimate and sit back, you know. If you don't turn up on the day, then someone's going to take it for you, you know. But I think, let's get this under our belt. Get to Wembley again. You never know, we could have two cups and fourth, and that'll do me.
Because Dalglish was saying that he reckons if Gerrard and Carroll are on top form, FA Cup...
They only started the game 6-1 against Brighton. That was the first time that Suarez, Carroll and Gerrard had started a game together, which is kind of strange. Like, you know.
Do you think that's going to pick up momentum now? Cup's going to...
I think, well, look, you know, look, we're in the quarterfinals, aren't we? You know, we're at home. Mm. Got to fancy your chances, haven't you?
It's quite a good match as well. Hopefully it won't be too tough.
I think on our day, if we raise our game, we can beat anyone, you know. But I don't want to hit you with a cliche. It's certainly a sports one, you know.
It's fine. You're a Liverpool fan. Yeah, it's fine.
We're full of cliches.
Euros. You got tickets for that? You going?
No, I haven't.
Watching it in the pub like everyone else.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, that's the way. Summer. It's good, isn't it? Because the football season's just going to carry on, you know. It's funny because I can take it or leave football, you know. It's kind of... I mean, I'm a big Liverpool fan and I follow it constantly, but I'm, you know, I've got other things in my life as well. I've got like a 7.5-month-old baby daughter, you know. I've got 2 teenage kids. I've got music I'm writing. And still trying to find the wonder in the day, like...
Do you find that having kids has changed the way you write or how you approach
your
music?
Haven't got time to pick up a pen.
They do it instead, just scribble.
No, I mean, I think life, look, you know, you're not meant to stay in one place and you just keep on moving and you come to, you know, certain points where you have to look at yourself in the mirror and, you know, sometimes that isn't quite an appealing thing, you know. And as long as you can keep moving on, I mean, you know, I've got nothing to tell people. People find it out for themselves. But life's good. I'm in a good place at the moment, you know.
Would you want your kids to get into music? Would you want them to get into a band? If they came back and went, Dad, this is
like
what I'm going
to
do.
I would like them, like, well, I said this to someone the other day, you know, I never cashed my dreams in for stability. And I hope that they don't either. I mean, in the sense that whatever they want to do, they have the strength of character to follow that through. And success is not about being popular, and success is not about having loads of cash. You know, it really isn't. It's about how you feel about yourself. And that's something, though, that takes a lifetime to learn, you know. It's not something that you learn when you're 21.
John, I'm going to let you get ready so you can upstairs and play to the masses. Can't wait to hear some of the new tracks.
Yeah, can't wait to play them.
Good luck with Time Bomb. Good luck with Trouble Times.
Thank you very much.
Out 5th of March.
That's right.
Happy days.
Happy days.
All right. Nice to meet you, John.
All right. Cheers.
Take it easy.
Thank you.
See ya.